Maybe you've heard of lab rats or guinea pigs, critters studied so thoroughly in laboratory research that they're known as model organisms. Well, the lab rat of the plant research world is Arabidopsis thaliana. This little guy has taught us so much about plant biology, but every model organism has its limits. No offense, but Arabidopsis can't teach us about color or complex flower shape and size, leaf patterning, biodiversity, animal pollination. But you know what can? Monkeyflowers.
I'm here with some amazing monkeyflower researchers at the University of Connecticut.
Hi.
What makes Mimulus such a good model organism other than its stunning good looks?
Well, first you want it to grow fast.
You also want something that stays relatively small, so you can see that these are not huge, but they're very happy here in our greenhouse.
They're so happy. We're in a Mimulus jungle right now.
Also, you want them to be easily manipulated so that we can do all sorts of different experiments to them in the lab.
And that's what we're going to explore today. Let's frolic through the Yuan Lab to find out what's so great about monkeyflower science. First, we'll talk to Amy about all things leaves.
My research is focused on phenotypic novelty. And basically, a novel phenotype is any phenotype that is qualitatively distinct from anything that we've seen before.
That means it like looks super different from anything else.
Exactly. Okay. As you can imagine, a lot of phenotypic novelties evolved a long time ago, and it can be really hard to find the genetic origins of those novelties because we're talking about things like turtle shells.
Zebra stripes.
Exactly. So these are things that evolved so long ago that now it's very hard to figure out which gene was responsible for giving rise to that phenotype.
Mm-hmm. So what's an example of a novel phenotype in Mimulus?
So this is Mimulus verbenaceous, and you can see it has this stripe across the leaves.
Oh, I love that.
Kind of like a zebra, but of Mimulus.
But much simpler and much more easy to study.
So most Mimulus don't make leaf stripes.
Exactly, and most plants don't make leaf stripes. This stripe is found in one population near Sedona, Arizona, and I actually went out to this population to collect tissue from plants that have the stripe and plants that don't have the stripe. And then we extracted their DNA and we were able to find out which gene actually controls the stripe formation.
Oh my gosh. By comparing their genetics, you can figure out the exact gene that causes the stripe.
Exactly.
So what was the gene?
So it is a gene that regulates anthocyanin biosynthesis, and we named it Stripey.
That's so perfect.
Stripey actually activates the late steps of the anthocyanin biosynthesis pathway.
Anthocyanin biosynthesis, that's a purple pigment. So that stripey gene is turning something on within that pigment production pathway?
Exactly. So it's actually turning on multiple steps of the pathway all at once.
Oh my God. Stripey, way to go.
So after we identified stripey, the next question that we asked is, what limits anthocyanin production just to the center of the leaf?
What makes stripey make such a nice stripe?
Right. Okay. In order to figure out which genes are keeping stripey in that nice center portion of the leaf, we did something called EMS mutagenesis.
EMS mutagenesis is a super cool technique scientists use when they want to figure out the gene that's responsible for a trait. Basically, you expose a ton of seeds to a chemical, EMS, which causes random mutations in their DNA. Then you let the seeds grow and look for ones where the trait you're studying is super messed up. In this case, Amy was looking for messed up leaf stripes.
We'll see all kinds of mutations, but we're only focused on the ones that have to do with that pattern.
So we ignore the other cool mutations. We only see, does it have a weird stripe, and then we know that something's going on with a gene that's interacting with stripey.
Correct. Okay. And we actually did find a lot of genes that interact with stripey.
Wait, so you got some weird stripes to show me?
We sure do.
Okay.
So in this individual, the stripe is sort of extended back towards the base of the leaf.
A chunkier stripe.
It's a chunkier stripe, okay. For sure.
Yes.
Right. So what that means is that we have a loss of function in a gene that normally would be active at the base of the leaf and preventing stripey from being expressed.
But now it's mutated, so it can't keep stripey in its place, and it's let stripey kind of make more pigment towards the base of the leaf.
Exactly.
Okay. And how do you figure out what that gene is?
Right, so we used a technique called bulk segregate analysis, and it basically helps us to just work backwards and figure out which gene has been mutated.
Okay.
And then once we have identified the gene, we can knock it down and see if that phenotype looks a lot like this one.
Okay, what did you find?
So it actually worked perfectly. So we identified a gene called ALOG1, we knocked it down, and as you can see, we've recreated the chunky stripe.
Oh, you have, oh my gosh, okay. That's really cool. So this plant is the result of random mutation, and this is the intentional mutant, where you've then identified that gene, turned it off, and then said, hey, this looks exactly like this with a chonky stripe.
Exactly.
So elegant, these experiments in Mimulus. Oh my gosh. This seems like a really incredible thing that you can do in this plant. You have this ability to manipulate genes, turn them on and off, like answer all of these questions about phenotypes using really nitty-gritty genetics.
Right, and that's part of what makes Mimulus so special. A lot of plants can't be manipulated like this.
Do you have any opposite, in the opposite direction, smaller stripes?
We do, actually. Okay. So we have some that completely lack a stripe, or they have just a little bit of stripey remaining.
Baby stripe. Yeah. Oh, even, it's just like a tiny little dot. So stripey is being not allowed to do its thing right now.
Right. So what this is telling us is that there are genes that actually help turn stripey on to make the stripe in the first place. So the next step would be to identify this gene as well and then knock it down, and we would expect the stripe to disappear in those knockdown lines.
This is a magical model system where you can figure out what's making weird leaf stripes. Oh, I love this.
So all of this natural variation is part of what makes Mimulus really interesting. We can study things like copper tolerance and salt tolerance, and then of course their flowers are beautiful, and so much cool research can be done on those.
And that's my cue to head over to Minya, our resident flower expert.
Minya!
Oh, hey, Molly!
Oh, I'm here to look at your flowers.
Come check this out.
I can look at flowers forever with you.
So there are many different species of Mimulus, and their flowers all look kind of different. And they're pollinated by several different pollinators. The final morphology of a flower, the size, the shape, the color, are great indications of what type of pollinators they try to attract.
Oh, okay, so we got some different flavors here. Who pollinates who?
So for example, this one is a typical bee-pollinated flower. We can see that there is a landing platform and a yellow nectar guide for the bee to enter the flower, to forage the nectar, to get the pollen, and pollinate the flower. But this one in front of me, for example, it has a very bright red color, and these flowers are pollinated by hummingbirds.
Oh wow, and the shape is super different. Like I can kind of see how a hummingbird beak would fit right in there. That's really cool. Mm-hmm.
Well, this species, the flower is very small compared to these two species, and it doesn't have much color at all. And that's because this is a species that becomes self-pollinated. It doesn't need any pollinators anymore.
So it's like, I don't need you animals, I'm gonna do it myself, I'm just gonna get small and like not have to bother attracting anyone.
Yeah, I can do it myself. The flowers of these species look very different, but actually they are closely related species that we can just cross them. Ooh. For example, we have a hummingbird pollinated flower, and then we have a tiny sulfur. Mm-hmm. If we cross them together, we'll have an F1 like this.
Oh, this looks amazing. Oh yeah, it's perfectly halfway, but why do you want to make all these crosses other than making cool looking flowers?
So making crosses like this can help us to understand and tease apart the genetics underlying what controls the shape, what controls the color, what controls the size.
Wow.
For example, this F1, the size and the color looks more like the hummingbird pollinated species, but the flexing of petal, for instance, looks almost exactly like the sulfur, meaning that this trait become decoupled from this parent.
Ah, and that'll help you sort of start to tease apart the genetics of each individual trait on its own.
Yes.
Okay.
At some point after many generations, we can get a flower that looks exactly like one of the parents with just one difference.
Oh, wow, it's like one gene controlling one trait.
Yes, we call these near isogenic lines.
Wow. Isogenic means the same gene, so it's like all the same genes as one of the parents minus one.
Yes, okay. With one difference.
Do you have any examples you can show me?
Of course. Molly, what difference can you tell between these two plants?
Oh, it's a quiz. Okay. I don't know, Minya, they both look like sulfurs to me.
If we look closely inside of the flower, we can see there's one difference, which is that this one has much darker pigmented pattern inside of the flower.
Yes, and so you've taken that dark pigmentation from another species and put it into the sulfur through lots and lots of crossing.
Exactly.
Nice.
So doing crosses and generating neos can help us to understand the existing variation that we see in nature. Like Amy mentioned just now, we can also use Mimulus to generate a lot of mutants that doesn't exist in nature, to help us understand what genes controls different aspects of flora development.
I really hope that means you're gonna show me some more cool mutants.
Of course.
Okay, great.
The Yuan Lab has lots of fabulous flower mutants, but the ones Minya is working on really come to life under the microscope. That's because she can create mutant monkey flowers that have fluorescent proteins attached to different molecules and genes that she's studying, which light up under the microscope and tell her where and when those genes are doing their thing in the flower. Let's take a look.
So what's going on right now is that this fancy microscope is shooting laser and scans through the flower bud.
That laser is making the fluorescent protein in the plasma membrane light up, and that's what we're seeing now.
Sliding through the sample with really, really thin slices, and eventually all the slices can be compiled together and do a 3D construction of our sample.
You've constructed this like beautiful visualization of this entire thing because we can light up the plasma membrane.
Exactly. Okay. And also we can do more than that.
Oh my God. Okay, who's this? What's red? Tell me everything.
So the red part is because in this plant, we not only have a plasma membrane marker to show us the cells, we also have another reporter that have a red fluorescent protein that can tell us where are the cells experiencing high concentration of auxin, which is a major, very important plant hormone.
How many combinations can you do? Can you do like auxin plus another gene? Like, can you
Of course. For example, here we can actually transfer different types of fluorescent proteins with different genes of interest into the same plant.
So we have like a gene over here, we have auxin over here, and now we can see how they're related. Is this saying that like the gene is where auxin isn't?
Yeah.
Oh wow, very cool. Okay.
So we can see this gene of interest and DR5 almost expressed in a complementary pattern.
Wow.
So they don't overlap, which is something very interesting. We can then try to study and understand why they're complementary, how do they actually interact.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's incredible.
I had the most magical monkey flowery day at UConn, and it wouldn't be complete without some final floral philosophizing with Amy and Minya.
So we have more than 300,000 flowering plant species. Arabidopsis is great, but it can only represent a very small portion of flowering plants that we have.
And there have been so many resources generated for Arabidopsis, and that's phenomenal. But having one model system really limits your ability to make new discoveries.
So we do need Arabidopsis. We also need other model systems such as Mimulus. All the things we showed you today, all the experiments, all the crosses, all the stuff, it's just the beginning.
So watch out, Arabidopsis. There's a new model system in town.